Why do West Africans often look naturally athletic and dominate in sports, while many native Mexicans seem naturally stocky and struggle to lose weight? Why do slim women in northern regions of Europe and Asia often have straighter figures, while equally slim women from desert regions can appear surprisingly curvaceous? These aren't just random quirks, they are living evidence of how our ancestors' bodies adapted to different environments across the world. Humans, after all, didn't just spread across the planet. We had to survive in every type of climate, from icy tundras to burning deserts. That survival left fingerprints on our bodies. Height, weight, fat, and muscles that are not evenly distributed across human groups. And those differences follow a logic written by evolution. Anthropologists often explain this through Allen's rule and Bergmann's rule. The first says that body proportions change with climate. In cold places, bodies minimize exposed surface area to hold on to heat. In hot places, they maximize surface area to shed heat. The second says that larger body masses are found in cold climates, smaller ones in hot regions. These rules aren't just textbook ideas. They are visible in the real differences we see between peoples today. To make sense of these patterns, scientists often talk about three main body types: ectomorph, mesomorph, and endomorph. Of course, every group has all three, but some appears more often in certain regions than others. Let's start with ectomorph. Ectomorphs are slim, light-framed people with narrow shoulders, thin bones, and low body fat. They don't put on muscle easily, and they often look graceful or delicate. Among the most extreme ectomorphs in the world are the Nilotic people of East Africa. Tall, very slender, and long-limbed. They score very low on what's called Rohrer's index, a way of measuring how slender someone is. Their build makes sense in a dry tropical climate. With long limbs and little fat, heat escapes more easily from the body. This same pattern appears in the majority among desert peoples, especially among Cushitic pastoralists, Saharan Tuaregs, Arabs of the Arabian Peninsula, the Khoisan of Southern Africa, Southern Australian Aborigines, and even the Apaches of the Mexican and American deserts. Even though their lives and cultures differ, their climate sculptured similar body types. But being the most dominant body type worldwide, not all ectomorphs look the same. Take the South Asian population for example. They have ectomorphic frames, slender bones, light builds, but they often show what people call a skinny fat appearance. Thin limbs but a softer belly. This is linked to thrifty genes, an adaptation to repeated cycles of feast and famine in history. The body learned to store fat very efficiently, especially around the waist, while keeping the limbs lean. In times of scarcity, this was a survival advantage. In the modern world of constant food supply, it often shows up as belly fat on otherwise slim bodies. That's why at certain age, most people with this body type develop the so-called dad bods. But here's where it gets more fascinating. Among women, being an ectomorph doesn't mean being without body fats. Female bodies still need to store fat for reproduction. In deserts and savanna populations, this often happens in hips, buttocks, and thighs. That's why slim women from these regions can still look very curvaceous. Sometimes, the fat concentration reaches an extreme called steatopygia. Among Khoisan women, the buttocks can store so much fat they form a pronounced curve while the rest of the body stays lean. These fat reserves act as insurance against famine and supported fertility, just like how camels store fat in their humps. Similar traits can be seen in other Africans or even the Onge of the Andaman Islands, where curviness comes from the same adaptation, survival in hot, unpredictable climates. Now compare this with ectomorph women from Northern Europe or East Asia. They may be equally slender, but often the fat storage is more even and less concentrated in the hips and thighs. The result is straighter figures, with less of the natural curves you see in equally slim women from the desert. Why? Because in colder places, what mattered was conserving heat and keeping energy for the whole body, not keeping selective results in one place. In East Asia, the genetic pattern of fat distribution is different again, often leading to flatter hips and buttocks. This is why skinny women don't look the same worldwide. Their environments shaped how their bodies carried the little fat they had. Moving on, mesomorphs are the classic muscular types. Think broad shoulders, strong chest, and natural athletic build. These are people who pack on muscle easily and burn fat quickly. West Africans often exemplify this body type, and that's why sprinters from this region dominate the world athletics. Mesomorphs are also common in parts of Europe, among Native Americans, and even in Australia. Historically, they made excellent hunters, since their bodies could generate bursts of power and speed. But there is a trade-off. Mesomorphs need more calories, which is a disadvantage in environments with frequent famine. In regions with more stable food supplies, like in tropical Africa or Polynesia, mesomorphs thrived. In fact, some of the largest-bodied humans recorded lived in Polynesia and Patagonia, where food from fishing and farming supported massive muscular frames. Finally, we come to endomorphs. These are the stocky, rounder body types with higher fat storage, softer features, and shorter limbs. Endomorphs gain weight easily, and they often look naturally padded. The extreme examples are found in the Inuit of the Arctic, some Polynesian groups, and Araucarians of South America. Their thickest bodies follow Bergmann's rule. Larger mass is better for conserving heat. Underneath the fat, many of these populations have a lot of muscle too, making them strong as well as insulated. Endomorphs are also found across Central and Eastern Europe, West Asia, Northern Asia, and even Central America. Here, the cold climate or unpredictable strictly vegetarian societies like Central Americans rewarded compact bodies that wasted little energy and needed fewer calories. That's why when you talk about Mexicans struggling to lose weight or Inuit carrying natural bulk, we are really talking about bodies fine-tuned for a cold world where food could be scarce. So when we compare these three types side by side, the picture becomes clearer. Ectomorphs thrive in hot, dry climates, often tall and slim, sometimes with striking curviness in women. Mesomorphs thrive where strength and calories are abundant, naturally athletic and muscular. Endomorphs thrive in cold climates, stocky and insulated. None of these are better or worse. They are different solutions to the same problem. How to keep the human body alive across extreme environments? Of course, this isn't a rigid system. You can find slim Mongols, even though endomorphs are common in Mongolia, or stocky Mediterraneans, even though ectomorphs are more typical in warm climates. Migration, mixing, and especially modern diets have blurred the lines. For example, Native Americans and Polynesians who once thrived on traditional foods often face extreme obesity today because their bodies weren't adapted for processed Western diets. Similarly, people with mesomorph builds may thrive on high-activity lifestyle, but struggle with weight when living sedentary lives. Still, the old evolutionary logic is there. The reason why West Africans often look naturally athletic, Why many Mexicans look naturally stocky, why Indians look skinny but carry a lot of belly fat, all comes down to the same story. Our ancestors, shaped by climate, famine, and survival. They show how clever evolution is at finding different paths to the same goal. And if you enjoyed learning about body types, check out my earlier videos about human height, eye types, nose shapes, hair texture, and skin color. They all fit into the same puzzle of why we look the way we do. And as always, stay curious, stay smart, and thank you very much for watching.